A metal 3D printing company 3D printing wood? Well, that's a little bit interesting. Let's talk about it in Maker Time. Thanks so much for joining us. My name is Grant. This is 3D Musketeers, and I am joined by the always effervescent Victoria, who she's been working hard. It's been a long day. She's decided to have herself a bit of a laydown. But let's get into it. Desktop metal. Desktop metal. 3D printing wood. The name's desktop metal. And they're gonna make a wood 3D printer, which, don't get me wrong, the name, amazing. Forust, F-O-R-U-S-T, Forust. Amazing name for a wood 3D printer. I think it's great. I mean, I think the name, given the fact that they're desktop metal and they're coming out with a wood 3D printer, but I have to say, this has got to be one of the best implementations of 3D printing wood that I have ever seen. I mean, literally, they're able to do actual freaking wood grain. And what you're seeing on the screen right now is the video on their website. We'll have the link to that in the description. But dude, the tech is so cool. They're using some sort of like 5 or 6 axis robotic arm to take all of this wood waste, right? Those chips, grind them up into a powder and reutilize it. From that one little snippet that we saw, the build volume does not appear to be all that large when you considering they're basically using wood powder that would normally be waste anyways. I'm gonna give them, you know, the tip of the non-existent hat. I think it's pretty cool. I see no reason that this doesn't catch on to be something really cool. And they're using an awesome 5 or 6 axis robotic arm to make this happen. So of course, not only is it a really beautiful print, but it's going to be absolutely gorgeous to watch. I mean, just seriously, I cannot get enough of their little GIF on their website. I think it's beautiful. And they're showing off some of their use cases, right? Interiors for cars, brilliant. Freaking brilliant. I would love to see Rolls-Royce, a la BMW, utilize this in their vehicles. It would allow them to give their customers one extra level of customization when they're working on their high-end vehicles. Because let's be real, who just goes out and buys a cookie cutter high-end vehicle? Literally nobody. Architecture'd be beautiful to see it as well. This may be a little unrealistic given how small that they themselves showed their build volume to be, but I believe over time we could get there. I would be curious to see how strong it is, but without spending a non-trivial amount of money, we really won't be able to test that, right? Because currently, it is just a service. They're not selling the machines as of yet. They're just kind of showing off what's possible, where they have actual wood grain, grainless wood, and then custom parts. I believe this is just printed. Yeah, it is. Okay. Process can be finished to mimic a wide variety of wood species. Currently available wood types include natural oak, teak, and walnut. So they must have some sort of binder, colored binder jetting, right? Desktop metal is a binder jetting process. So that's how this is all going together. So my guess would be that they have a relatively clear, a relatively dark, and then variations of different colors. So maybe a brown, a yellow, something like that to kind of give you those, you know, tones of wood grain. There's very, very little knowledge about this just yet. This is right from their website, which is forust.com. I think it's great that they're giving us actual data. The density can be variable, which I guess all depends on the type of wood dust that you're using. The 1.2 grams per cubic centimeter. I'm wondering if that's using like IPE. Look at that arm, it's so cool. They do have different sizings. So, I mean, geez, 180 centimeter. That's a big print. So what we likely first saw in that video was this machine, their smaller variant. next to a knee mill, which is kind of funny that it's next to like a bridge port. Their larger machine, which is capable of 1800 by 900 by 300 centimeters, is apparently powered by a Varitas 3D arm. It's really, really cool. I mean, gosh, that build volume is amazing. And they say 106 liters per hour. If you have a really small part, the arm only has to move a little bit. But I believe the recoder, which is what puts down the layer of powder, has to go all the way across every time. As someone that's ran powder printers for many years and at their peak was literally voted the best in the world, they really only run at basically one speed. Yes, if you have very few parts in the build volume, you can run them just a hair faster, but basically it takes the same amount of time for everything. I think their parts are gorgeous though, and it's clear that they're doing some sort of finishing technique where you can add either like a polyurethane or leave it raw. They've got some prints and samples that they're selling, which I think is really, really cool. They've got a store here where you can take a look at buying some parts, but unfortunately they're way more expensive than I was expecting, right? Wood dust is ostensibly free, okay? Nobody is paying right now to get rid of wood dust, right? And there are very few companies that are buying it. Like, I guess if you're in the MDF business, you might be buying wood dust, but kind of otherwise, nobody really buys it, okay? So, I mean, really cool, but dude, a set of 16 swatches, which I assume are like, you know, an inch, maybe two, for $40 plus shipping and taxes. I don't know. I think it's cool, but I think we have to see where the technology ends up. I would love to get my hands on one, but it's likely going to be way outside of our budget, but that's okay, because this technology is going to get into the hands of professionals, and we're gonna see some cool stuff come out of it. I wanna see more furniture. I think the bowls and baskets and trays and vessels and all that, I think they're cool. But I really wanna see somebody unlock this technology and really take a look at it for what it is. It is mass production binder jetting, which worries me that X1 might have a bit of a claim to this, but hey, I don't know. It is curious nonetheless. I'm excited. I think this is a great step forward. I think it's weird given the fact that the company's name is Desktop Metal and their product is called Forust and it's wood. But again, you kind of have to improvise, adapt, and overcome to continue to be relevant in this industry. So I like their goal, right? They're founded to make high volume wood 3D printing affordable, reliable, and sustainable. Reliable is the one that we will see if it actually works, right? Desktop Metal utilizes binder jetting already for their metal 3D printers. They're basically FDM with added binder with crazy amounts of powder, and then you sinter it out. So the technology for them is very similar to what they're used to. It's just a different medium, which, okay, mildly similar. They're utilizing waste from both sawdust and lignin, so it is very much a, you know, we can take all your scrap and make it usable again. I think custom woodworker shops or custom wood shops, custom cabinet makers might see a benefit from having a machine like this if they are very, very, very high end and active. Because otherwise it will be a very large capital expense that might not necessarily see an ROI as quickly as they would want. I like that they're looking at achieving net zero carbon emissions, but like you're not, because there's so many other processes involved in here that apply to carbon emissions, and you're really not like taking a look into that. I understand that we're cutting down less trees, but net zero carbon emission is not actually true here. There is money involved and carbon involved to produce the actual machine, the ink, the binder that you're gonna be using. It's generally, I've always called it ink because in the process that we've used, it's CMYK and clear, so it is literally ink. Their process is clearly an ink jetting type of material and formulation, so I'm gonna call it ink and binder. It's the same thing for the purposes of this video. I think it's cool, but it is not net zero carbon emission. Unless they're doing something else to offset it, it's not net zero. It's less waste, totally less waste, but it's not net zero. So I don't know. I understand that the sawdust is either burned or sent to a landfill. It can be harmful to the environment, but it's also used in MDF, right? So it does get repurposed. I don't know. I think that this is more kind of marketing wank than anything else. Don't get me wrong. I think it's cool. I think it's really cool. But I do want to see where this ends up. Again, honestly, the coolest thing about this is their video. I really like their video. And I think their video shows the capabilities of their machine. But because this is brand new, there's a lot to be seen here. We've got a couple of articles. This is their official press release from their website. It's great. I like that they're working on this greener technology. I really believe that's where the industry should be pushing itself toward. But we do need to really look at what we're saying and what we're promising, because those two things are very different, right? We're saying net zero, but it's really not. Now, their big arm that had the Veritas 3D arm on it, they're calling it the Ram 336. I don't honestly know why. I like that they can print digital grain. I think that's incredibly valuable when you're looking at a custom manufacturer that would like to have custom wood grain and maybe be able to imprint certain things on it. That to me is totally cool. The digital grain is printed on every layer, and parts can then be sanded, stained, polished, dyed, coated, and refinished in the same manner as traditionally manufactured wood components. And unlike MDF, which is medium density fiberboard, there's LDF, low density fiberboard, and HDF, high density fiberboard. But unlike those fiberboards, you can actually include digital grain. So when you do go to sand it, when you do go to stain it, you're going to get the effect that you're looking for rather than something that's just very plain. I will be curious to see how its water and liquid uptake is comparatively to other fiber-based wood parts, you know, MDF and the like, because it should be relatively similar unless you seal it. But if you've ever tried to seal MDF, it sucks up whatever sealant that you're putting in it very, very quickly because the wood is incredibly dry. I would be curious to see what they're making their binder out of, because one of the main binding components inside of MDF is formaldehyde, and obviously a little dangerous to humans. I like that they are able to produce wood grains, including rosewood, ash, zebrano, ebony, and mahogany, among others. I think that's awesome, and they're going to be adding more throughout the process. The ones that they're supporting at launch will be just natural oak, ash, and walnut. So they have plans to bring in more to make these machines more valuable. Well, I support it. Can we afford it? Probably not. We can't afford desktop metal 3D printers, so the chance of us being able to afford a Forust printer is going to be quite low. But I will work on trying to get some samples in hand, because it would be pretty cool to give them the what for and the what why. I'm curious to see where this technology goes, and I hope you are too. If you like videos like these where we go through interesting industry topics, let us know in the comments down below. And if you find something you want us to cover, please let us know as well. We'll be happy to do a video all about it where I give my opinion to you, the viewer. Don't forget to get subscribed, ring that bell, and hey, hit the like button while you're down there. It helps our channel grow. But my name is Grant. This is 3D Musketeers. Don't forget to call your loved ones. And as always, keep making awesome. Have a good one. This also, look at this belly. There's just so much belly here. Gosh. I'm gonna put a sensor bar or something.